Thank you very much. I'm more than a little intimidated having Dr. Price here, who's probably one of the most. I'm elevating you, Gordon. To me, you're a doctor. Okay. Dr. Oldowater, the chair of the board, and there's many people here who I know have a tremendously broad experience and knowledge in public policy and transportation. So I'm feeling like, what am I doing up here? I should be back there taking notes. But I guess being the chair of Mayor's Council does provide an interesting perspective, because it seems to me that the way things worked out right now, it seems that a lot of the media and a lot of the public are somehow expecting that the Mayor's Council is going to solve all the transportation problems in the Lower Mainland, and sort of created one of those, how did I find myself here? Where did that misconception come from? And how do we take all the incredible ability and resources and the success of TransLink over the years? I'm a former director. I'm a proud former director of TransLink. I was fired by legislation 5 years ago, but I've been very supportive of the work that the board's been doing all along. And I think from a political point of view, those of us who are involved in the Mayor's Council, we come from all political stripes, left, right, and whatever. And we get along pretty well together. And I have to say that Mayor's Council is immensely functional, respectful of each other, and we bring forward sort of a collective view. And I think perhaps the reason that I'm back again is that I am a political moderate. I am solution-oriented as opposed to partisan and have any particular ideology. And I think that I'm going to start off with a few comments on governance with TransLink, because I think from all the experts I've listened to, if in any organization, if you don't get the governance exactly right, it's really difficult to solve some of the problems that any operating entity is tasked with. So to start off with, I'd like to emphasize that the starting point is that basically we have an extremely functional public transportation system. The media and the public seem to take great delight in kicking the hell out of TransLink at every available opportunity. In fact, it's become one of the local national sports. And I just wish that for once a lot of our people would get their heads out of the trough and go and take a look around the world and recognize the fact that on a comparative basis, we do have one of the best systems in the world. So let's build on what's good. Let's fix what's wrong, and let's work together. And that's certainly the message that I've been sending to our minister, message I'm trying to enforce to the media all the time. I'm getting a little edgy lately because my colleagues are getting a little edgy and I'm their spokesperson. It's difficult to know exactly how to position oneself when you're trying to sort of fix all of those problems, when virtually all of the power to legislate and to change things for the better lies in Victoria. So anyway, let's run through. I'm going to get told I'm gonged in 20 minutes, and I know 20 minutes goes very quickly, so we'll work through these. The first issue is most of you here know darn well what governance is. Nancy, you've got a PhD in governance and public policy, so I'm not going to go too long. You don't. Okay. I'm not going to go too long about this, except to say that it's extremely important that we get it right. And I have to say, from a Mayor's Council perspective, I don't think we have it right yet. I think we've got parts, and I think we need to tweak it. So how does the governance framework exist here? I was trying to, I had a CBC TV French reporter in my office this morning, and I was trying to explain, it was English as a second language to him, and I was trying to explain so he could ask questions. And after 30 minutes, he was so frustrated that he walked out shaking his head, and he just could not comprehend. But the challenge I think we have is that TransLink really has this sort of a box, I look at it, where we've got Mayor's Council, the TransLink Commission, and the TransLink Board of Directors. We're within that box, and we do have sort of different sort of levels of ability to affect policy. For example, we appoint the directors, and the directors, of course, are the ones who deal with all the day-to-day operating decisions, etc. And yet, most of the public seems to perceive that the Mayor's Council is the critical body, and part of the reason for that is because, from the outside, the provincial government throws back, if you like, the public accountability and says, well, the Mayor's Council has to figure out, the Mayor's Council has to figure it out, the Mayor's Council has to figure it out. We were removed from any significant legislative authority 5 years ago in an attempt to fix this system, and now we have, unfortunately, we have the provincial government saying that it's the Mayor's Council's responsibility to fix it, even though it was removed from any principal operating decisions and authority at all. So it's a bit of a confusing situation. On the outside, we have the Federal Provincial Government and Transport Investment Corporation that deal with the large capital grants and that are essential in order for us to do the very large projects. For example, we're talking about UBC I know in the media yesterday, we've got the two mayors of Vancouver and Surrey talking about the importance of moving ahead with rapid transit to UBC and with south of the Fraser with a ground level light rapid transit system. That's going to require a huge amount of money that's going to come literally from the federal government and the provincial government. Well, we need to get all the stuff in the box right first so we can decide how to prioritize and do that work. And I think the point I'm trying to make is that work needs to be done by the TransLink board, needs to be done by the Mayor's Council, it needs to be done by the province, working closely together and not operating in completely separate boxes the way it is right now. So, moving on a little further, so who does what within Metro Vancouver? Well, at the policy levels, I mentioned, there's four of us within the box, and you do need to have a roster. It's like going to some strange exotic game you've never seen before, your first American football game as a Russian tourist and trying to understand the rules and things. Well, you need to almost have that level of understanding to really understand who does what within that box. The management level and the implementation level are pretty clearly the TransLink board and TransLink staff, okay? And I think that's pretty clear, the blue and the yellow. And I think the way the challenge is we need to fix what's in the box. I think I've worked with a lot of organizations over the years, and I think TransLink has an immensely capable staff who are amazingly resilient given the constant criticism and misunderstanding directed towards their efforts. So what are desirable governance attributes? I borrowed this slide, and when I saw it yesterday, all the wheels were turning. It was just great. I got lost in the thing. Now they stopped turning, so it must be something to do with this system anyway. We have engaged, Mayor's Council has engaged a series of consultants to take a look at world practice, best practices for governance. They've delivered an initial report last week, and they're going to give us a detailed report to March, which we're going to obviously give to the TransLink board right away and the government, et cetera. It's designed to facilitate a better understanding of where we move from here. And they came forward, and this work was done by a lot of it by Ken Cameron and Clive Rock, who are veteran planners in public transportation within the region that many of you know. And they came forward with this particular slide and talked about accountability, advocacy, transparency, responsiveness, clarity of purpose, and productive relationships. And I'm not going to start going into each one of these because I don't have time and whatever. But the detail, when they explained it and went into this, they basically said that whereas the current governance model does respond to some of these, a lot of them it misses the mark. And, oh, there they go, look at that. You see, and they're all turning, and it's just the way it's supposed to work. So that's where we want to get to. And maybe there's two slides here. There we go. Oh, look at this. Look at that. I just showed up as green and blue. This is the rating structure they use when comparing Metro Vancouver with some of the other top transportation systems in the world. And again, they use those six qualities, and they give a relative rating. So, boy, this is wonderful. All right. Now, that is Metro Vancouver. So we're sort of 1 to 2 stars. And again, this isn't a measure of our overall effectiveness as individuals or any reflection of the quality of staff. It's the structure and how well the structure responds to the area's needs. And then the sample peer group is there, which says that we're probably doing a pretty good job despite the fact that the governance model is a constraint. Well, you might say, well, if we're doing a pretty good job, then maybe there's an argument for not touching the governance model. The challenge we have is that going over to here, Vancouver is not a static environment. We're not Cleveland. You know, we're not static population or declining. We're growing dramatically, and we have a footprint which is pretty well unique in the world. There's a few cities like Stockholm that perhaps are a little bit alike, but not quite the way we are with mountains in the north and a major body of ocean so close in the west. Our population is continuing, as is our economic growth, and that was one of the principal messages that Mayor Robertson was delivering yesterday about the economics of the UBC line. Faster growth in demand for travel options. The better you are, the more people will use you. And the more they use you, you're obviously going to find that the need for transportation exceeds the growth of population. The funding portfolio is what I'm supposed to be talking about, and I'm going to make sure I get into it pretty darn quickly in the last 10 minutes, is not keeping pace. Existing sources are increasingly volatile. We found out within the last year that gas tax is really maxed out. And I can tell you from a political point of view, from local governments, that property tax is also maxed out. And as we go into the next slide, this is, I think, just some statistics here that my good friend Jeff Cross here provided with me just the other day. Population is growing, but if you take 6%, but if you take a look, vehicle growth is lagging a little behind population growth. And of course, walking is increasing, but if you look at the ridership increase in public transportation, there's obviously a clearly articulated need. And cycling, which is a smaller group, but obviously is growing 4.5 times that of the population. So what do we have here? Well, we have revenue streams, and these lines, that for those of you who can't, I guess hopefully you can see that, it's pretty good. The green line, of course, is the is transit fares, and you can see that right now, 40% of, when you get on the bus, 40 cents of the cost comes from the money you put in the fare box or your pass. 60 cents has to be subsidized from somewhere else, okay? And the two major subsidies at this point are fuel tax, and you can see what's happening with fuel tax. It's coming down, and it's coming down for a variety of reasons. One is because we're being good boys and girls. We're buying more fuel-efficient cars. We're driving less and taking public transportation more. We're carpooling a little bit more, so that's good. So the challenge, of course, is that the higher you push gas tax, which is not a direction that we're recommending, you're going to actually end up with fewer gross dollars because fewer liters of gas are being used throughout the region. That's good from almost every benchmark. But then the amount of money going towards public transit is actually going to decline. So you can't. It's self-defeating. You can't use gas tax. Carbon tax, to a certain extent, will have the same impact. If you rely on carbon tax and put additional carbon tax on, ultimately it will also drive people out of cars, and you'll probably end up saying, gee, there's only a limited amount of carbon tax that would respond. And then finally, property tax. And you can see the property tax has weaned. It stopped at 30%. It's declining down 23%. That's largely as a result of other sources of funding picking up, which you can see here. So from our perspective, we're looking for a new source of revenue. There's really two classifications, if you like, macro classifications. One is direct users and tax, user fees and taxes. And these are sources of revenue where there's a clear correlation between you getting on the bus or getting in the car, or the decision you make to travel from point A to point B, and how much you pay. And obviously, if you're in the car, you're making a decision to travel as quickly as you want to go, but you've got to pay motor fuel tax, if you're parking sale tax, potentially, which ultimately is paid by the tenant or the landlord. And obviously, if you go on the public transit, you're paying in the fare box, et cetera. So those are the kinds of things that deal directly with use. The beneficiary fees means there's a broader sort of soft benefit. For example, if you live in West Vancouver and don't own a car, you're paying property tax. The property tax enables a public transportation system to exist if you use it as a convenience, even though you may not use it very much. And I think most of us argue most of the things municipal governments do, providing police, providing fire, providing community centers, all those things, those are all broad uses. If you don't use the community centers, you're still living in a healthy community, because when that community has it, it increases the public health and safety and everything else. Okay, so those are the two basic categories. So what falls into where? Well, as I mentioned, user fees, transit fares, fuel tax, parking sales tax, and the road tax, which we'll talk about that in a little more detail in a second. But road tax is really a huge bucket of tools and application bases for those tools that develops a clear relationship between how far you travel, what time of day you travel, what kind of vehicle, how many of you are in the car, and how it's priced. You can call it road pricing. I think Peter Ladner was writing about this a couple of years ago. Peter used to talk about demand management routinely was the language that he would use. I'm sure, Gordon, you use a whole variety of different words to describe it. It's not one concept and one measure. It's being used all over the world. One a lot of people are familiar about, of course, is the center of London, which I've spent a day in the London Transport about 2 years ago. And it's simply you cross the line to go through the core. You pay your license plate photo's taken. You know, they find out where you live. You get a bill in the mail. In a sense, I guess the Portman is a little bit like that right now. It's just simply a basic toll if you cross over the bridge. The beneficiary taxes, these are already in place. The property tax, the hydro levy, and the replacement tax. Those are already in place, and those, for the most part, are the hydro levy and replacement tax are fairly small, but they're constant. So we're at a crossroads with respect to where we go now. As I've mentioned, gas tax and property tax, which form, I think in that last diagram, is about 50-55% of the funding right now, those are maxed out. We know that if we increase, and some of you would, I'm sure, share that perspective, if we increase the amount we charge people to take public transit right now, many people that take transit are in the lower income groups. it's a huge cost already. I rode in with the mayor of Penticton from the airport back to downtown yesterday, and at $9 to come one way on the SkyTrain, he just about choked. He couldn't believe it. I'd lend him the money to come in. So we recognize the fact that there's constraints, and certainly TransLink and TransLink board do. So we're reaching the limits. So where do we go now? Well, these are the four criteria that are consistent. The current government has provided these criteria, and we, you know, we take them seriously as well. I know Premier Clark was elected party leader on the basis of this. The challenge we have, of course, is when we're trying to figure out, when we get these given back to us as conditions to try and find new revenue sources, affordable for families. Well, obviously we want to try and keep the fare box low, but if you don't have public transportation, what option does that give families who are struggling to pay bills? So it's one of those difficult things to get your head around. Are you better to try and have a robust transportation system with lots of options, and if that's the case, we need to build it, and the money has to come from somewhere. We fully agree about regionally based. We don't think that Princeton and Prince George should be funding transit in the Lower Mainland. They've got BC Transit to look after them. We've never for a second thought the rest of the province should be subsidizing this region. Support the provincial economy. That was the thrust of Mayor Robertson's argument yesterday, supporting the provincial economy. And there's no question Metro Vancouver is the huge economic driver within the province. And it's very important that we make sure we have efficient movement of goods and people through here. And capture the benefits from transport investment. I suppose that comes right down to the best example, of course, is the Cambie line. I've got other colleagues, if any questions come up, I've got Councillor Meggs here who can talk more about the economics of that. But we agree, I think, as a mayor's council, that if you're going to all of a sudden extend a rapid transit line, billions of dollars, and it's going to very specifically benefit a certain area around there, especially real estate development, that some of the money from the real estate development should go back to pay for that rapid transit system right away. To me, there's an obvious linkage right there, and I think most of us get that. So, silver bullet or silver buckshot? I love this expression. It was Peggy Hunt at TransLink, I think, who sort of first dropped this one to me. There is no silver bullet. There's no one source that if we sort of pull this one out of the bucket, it's going to solve all of the problems. We've already got about five or six sources, and we've seen several of them are capped. Probably if there's one that's closest to a silver bullet, a single item, it probably would be road pricing, because as I said, road pricing is a large bucket. You can actually apply road pricing in a whole series of different ways, and that's probably the subject of a much longer sort of discussion, and maybe in the 30-40 minutes we have today, maybe some of those ideas will come out. And the issue of silver buckshot, I think, makes some sense. And when the minister asked us a month ago, come forward, give us five different funding options. We didn't pull these out of out of our own research. We pulled these out of the work that the province had done with TransLink. Some of the people in this room did the work with the joint technical report a year and a half ago. It's sitting there. It's best practices from throughout the world. We didn't pull out five that were new or anything else. There's a lot of ranking work that's been done. Jeff and Cross here in front row has done a lot of the work for TransLink. So we're heavily dependent upon the province and TransLink for this kind of information. And the ones that ranked highly with all the work done that was shared by the province and TransLink was carbon tax, because again, it relates specifically to human behaviors and desired behaviors. The fuel tax, discussed the limitations. Parking sales tax, 21%, probably maxed out and very unpopular in the business community. Road pricing, transit fares, and the vehicle levy. We know the vehicle levy right now, it's been there since 1999, is my understanding. It's just there's no way of collecting it. We can't collect I think mayors and the former TransLink board and mayors have tried three times, I believe. Once with the NDP government, I think about 10, 12 years ago, with Glenn Clark government. Once under Premier Campbell, once under Premier Clark. The mayors and local politicians have said, let's move forward with it. We need the legislation to collect it through ICBC. And all three times it's been shot down at the political level and in the public without any detailed public discussion. So there's not much in that first bucket except, as you can see, the road pricing and then the vehicle levy and the carbon tax, and we'll talk about those later. And land value capture, we've already said we're supportive of that. Property tax is already there. Then you get into some of the ones lower down, and I'll throw sales tax in a sec, because sales tax sort of came out of right field. We had an all-day discussion in January, and one of our members said, look, we've never put sales tax in there because we recognize the fact that the provincial government clearly has that's a major source of their revenue. we're all trying to argue for tax room. You know, our schools and hospitals have to be funded. Our roads have to be funded. We're trying to stay away from getting into the province's tax room. But somebody pointed out that even 0.1% sales tax, provincial sales tax, I think it's 20 million bucks?
50
million. Thanks, Jeff. Okay. I was low. 50 million bucks goes a long way. Going at provincial sales tax from 6% to 6.2% is not something most people would notice as a huge, huge step. And yet that would provide $100 million a year towards public transit in the Lower Mainland. So we thought, gosh, when we saw the scope of the numbers, we thought we've got to put that out there for discussion. Well, of course, we put it out there, and that's all the media jumped on. My head was on the chopping block because I was sort of out there sort of, you know, advocating sales tax, all the response. It was all predictable. I mean, in this business, whether it's Nancy out there making public statements or me or somewhere else, you know that you're going to get your head chopped off, you know, in the next 3 days in the media. But sales tax is used, and it is used throughout North America in various jurisdictions. And you can see why, because a tiny adjustment can bring a staggering amount of money in for public transit. So, I've talked about these. We'll talk about them again. How am I doing for time, by the way? How much? 5 minutes. Okay, good. I'll be finished long within 5 minutes. So that slide's good. It's almost a concluding one because it gives you some scope of these fees, and you can certainly see there with the sales tax, the 25 to 250 million. So Jeff, you said 50 million is 0.1%. $250 million would be pushing sales tax from 6 to 7%, just a one, you know, adding 1%, half a percent? God, my math's terrible. I'm a CA too, I should be ashamed. Okay. So 0.5% gives a quarter of $1 billion a year towards public transit in the Lower Mainland. That's why we put it in here. I'm still not so sure that, you know, step back and wear my provincial citizen hat, I'm still not so sure if that's the right thing for the province because, you know, schools and hospitals and other things need to be funded as well. But the numbers are the relevant thing for us to understand. Road pricing, again, it depends on two things. One is how broadly you tend to sort of levy, and classic example is let's look at the high occupancy vehicle lanes. You know, from a philosophical point of view, you could continue to say, you know, if you travel in that lane, if they had a pricing system, you could say, let's forget about having only three people in the vehicle travel in that lane. How about we say anyone can travel in that lane, but you pay $1 a kilometer, which means if you're wealthy and own a Porsche and you want to drive to Surrey, you can go flying down that lane, and it'll cost you $100 each way, but you can pay it, and you're happy to contribute to the rest of the system. Or should we be saying, no, we want to encourage the three people to a car, can use it, and they can travel for free in that lane to relieve the capacity for somewhere else. So you've got a whole series of choices that you can use. That's an extreme one. But you really need to take a look, and you need to have that kind of broad dialogue throughout the entire region, because you need to, it's probably a two-year consulting phase. You need to go out to the public, and you need to have a lot of the academics, a lot of the media involved, because it has tremendous social implications for our region in order to do it. It's certainly a lot more complicated than jacking up sales tax by 0.3%. You can understand, if you want money tomorrow, road pricing is probably a 3 to 4 year voyage with a huge amount of political controversy, elections underway, petitions, people in favor of it, people against it, major angst within the region. You can understand why provincial governments and federal governments probably want to stay away from it and hand it over to the local governments, you know, as to be the cannon fodder, in a sense. And land value capture, again, the challenge with land value capture is if you increase a bus route, you know, along Mount Seymour Parkway, you're not going to get much land capture value, and you're not going to be able to get much back. I think you're really talking about land capture value, and chop me off at the ankles if I'm wrong, Gordon, but you're really talking about SkyTrain, where you're talking about moving large numbers of people, and you're creating a lot of density around a particular route, which probably isn't rubber vehicles, rubber-tired vehicles. It's probably rail, correct? Depends on the right. Okay, well, we'll probably hear a little bit more about that later. So, the end. So, I came in under the wire. The final point I'd like to make, if I could, is that there's so many good people and good ideas and good energy already in this city. And I think the message that I'm trying to take to Minister, and I'm flying over Monday morning with Mayor Wright from Westminster, is why does it have to be so hard? What we want to do, and what my understanding is happens in Germany, this is what our consultants told us just a couple of weeks ago, is if you want good public transit, you need to have the good governance in place. And Germany leads probably the world in many ways, and the reason they do is because traditionally they have the stakeholders and the various levels of government all sitting around the table, sharing the risk and sharing the planning at the same time. And when you do that, everybody has to concede a little bit. What we have right now is lots of good people, lots of good thoughts, but it's so siloed. Responsibility for planning being in Metro Vancouver, responsibility for the transportation planning lying within the boxes that I've shown right here, that needs to be fixed. Same people, different boxes, different colored arrows. Okay, and hopefully that's the discussion we'll have in the next 30 minutes. We'll mine that through a bit. So thanks for your patience. Anyway, okay.
So I suspect we're going to have a lot of questions. Just so you know, we are recording the session, so if you have questions, we'll bring the mic to you so the people who are watching us online can hear your questions
as well. And if I could, there's so many people here who can answer some of these questions better than me that I'm wondering if I can deflect, with permission of a few people in here, deflect some of the questions and answers, because I think it'd be more value to the audience if I do that, if that's okay.
Too afraid to get your head chopped?
Nancy, you okay to answer a few questions? I'm deflecting Gordon and Jeff and any others here that think they can give a good crack at it. So, okay.
Who wants to go first?
Okay.
I have a question up here. Could you just please give us your name?
Yeah, my name is Eric Doherty, and I want to, I agree with you that TransLink is one of the best transit agencies in North America. And one of the things that's really good about TransLink is the move they've made in the last year or so to actually put transit first, to put transit first in the funding priority line. And about $500 million, $500 million worth of road expansion projects, particularly the North Fraser Perimeter Road, have been taken off the table so that we can fund transit. So I want to ask you, is that something that you're asking the provincial government to do, to actually put, for example, the $3 billion proposal for the replacement of the Massey Tunnel on hold and put that money towards transit instead?
Good question. Okay, I guess I'll respond a comment back from, I think it was my colleague Mayor Brody over the tunnel, and of course Mayor Brody is the north end of that tunnel, and I guess it was if you spent the same money on the tunnel on public transportation within the region, especially south of the Fraser, could you reduce the amount of traffic that's going through that tunnel to the extent when you wouldn't need to expand it, for example? I realize it's an old tunnel, and there's obviously the issue of wear and tear, et cetera. But the question is, and this came forward when the Port Mann project was announced, I think about 5 years ago, when it was announced by the transportation minister at the time. And I think a lot of us who were heavily involved in local transit thought, where was the business case that said that we need to expand the Port Mann Bridge and increase the capacity over putting that same amount of money in building the most robust public transit system in the world? If we can take 30% of our people off the roads by putting them in efficient public transit, would we have needed to build the Port Mann Bridge in the first place? And I think that the position that we have is, I don't think you can and should plan goods movement and people movement separately. I think you need to build a business case based on full life cycle cost for the 20 or 40 or 50 year life of whatever it is, and you need to compare them, because I think you should find that increasing road space and bridge capacity should be fighting for the same public dollars that increasing transit for moving people. I think we have enough roads in for moving goods around in Metro Vancouver now if we get a lot of the cars off the road. I think the capacity is there. And if we can encourage even a lot of the goods movement to use roads on more of a 24-hour basis than now, as opposed to during rush hour, by incentivizing trucking companies, for example. Part of road pricing is that you can actually get people to be incentivized to travel during those slower times and away from congestion. So shift that traffic away from congestion by charging more for people traveling in rush hour and less in the peak and evening periods, when you can move goods virtually for free instead of charging them, for example, for moving during the day. Those are the kinds of discussions that you can't have just at Mayor's Council, you can't have just on the TransLink board, because they're only responsible for a limited amount of roads. You need to have, and the province again holds responsibility through the ministry for all of that. And those are the conversations and questions we need to have. So I appreciate your question.
Can you please introduce yourself?
Stephen Rees. My question is really about the boundary effect. Mm-hmm. And I understand. I think one of the clever things about the sales tax is it's so small that it doesn't actually drive people over the boundary.
Correct.
But the benefiting area tax is a real problem. And this is my experience in Toronto. It goes back a long way, I'm sorry to say. When the Shepherd Subway started,
yep.
The first developer, the first intersection east of Yonge, he was going to do the building on top of the station, and that was
right.
going to pay for the station. And that seemed to him to be fine. He could do that. But then he was going to have to pay a levy as well.
Mm-hmm.
At which point he said, I can do this at Steeles and not pay anything. I
yep.
go into York Region, and they won't.
Yes.
If we do a benefiting area tax here, mm-hmm. don't we shove it all out to Abbotsford or up to Squamish or something?
Well, that's a great question. I'll be blunt, I can't answer. And being in a suburb that doesn't have any rapid transit of that extent, we've not had to engage those issues. I would certainly deflect that question to either Councillor Meggs or to Dr. Price.
I think you can say that happened in Surrey Centre.
Okay, actually, we can. Good. I'll let you gentlemen to engage in the dialogue, because I'm in the learning mode now as opposed to the teaching mode. So,
not exactly sure of the details, but when SkyTrain was extended to Surrey Centre, they did have a development cost charge, as we'd call it then, mm-hmm. for development around it. Got very little development. Surrey took that off. Results speak for themselves.
Great. In which case, when we agree conceptually that we need to look at that at the Mayor's Council, because the minister and the ministry has been very clear in the current government that they need us to do that, we can't have that conversation on our own. That needs to be held in a broad forum with UDI sitting up there, with the province, and with all the stakeholders, because obviously if it's going to be introduced and it's going to be seen as an impediment like that, then it's going to fail before it starts. So that we have to mine that through to the region. And that's why I talk about everybody having to be in the same tent. I think Jeff wants to respond too, so I'll pass that down. Good.
I don't claim any huge expertise necessarily, but it seems to me that if you want the revenue for rapid transit, then the benefit has to flow back to the people who are doing the development. And you know, there's not an infinite pot there with the densities that are available, especially if there's community oversight of over how tall the building is. So in Hong Kong, the transit authority builds the buildings and takes all the revenue, and they go quite high. And those are questions that are going to be hard to answer within current planning, and I don't care whether it's in Surrey or Vancouver or anywhere else. So I think the area benefiting tax is a bit of a dud, to be honest. It might work out at UBC if UBC decided that they would divert money that they would otherwise use for post-secondary education and put it into transit investment, because they could get to do the whole thing. They own the land, and they could do the development, they could get the revenue and so forth. They don't have to share it with the municipality. And I know there's folks here who work in the development sector. It's the same issue people say, and I had it said to me last night. We'll just put in more density. And I invite people to share some of my time at public hearings and see how well that works. But also, I think that even if there was much more density available in terms of public consensus, the history has been that municipalities seek to use that to mitigate the supposed negative effects of the density by putting it into parks, social housing, and you name it. So there's no sort of untouched pot there in terms of development. I also would say, and you explained it quite well, Richard, that sales tax is a non-starter, and the quicker people give up on that idea, the better. You know, of course, if you did personal income tax at a very low level, it would raise a lot of money too, but that's not going to happen, in my view.
See, I think it's a very complex area that these two gentlemen just answered it, that probably most of my colleagues on Mayor's Council haven't a clue, because we're not dealing with those issues in our communities. There's probably only about four councils that have dealt with this issue as part of, you know, their policy discussions. Therefore, that's why those discussions need to be focused, and all of the stakeholder groups need to be involved with the province. Yes.
Hi, I'm Erin Omlin. I'm part of a regional organization called Hub, Your Cycling Connection.
Yep.
And we see lots of benefits to better public transit and to all sustainable forms of transportation. Very pleased to see you guys talking about all these different ways to raise the funds. And I know that the province really does hold the control here. And so my question is, how can public, whether it's individuals or organizations, help support you to make these changes with the province, to get them to agree that this is a good thing, that you can go further on all of those different solutions that you're talking about?
Okay, well, I would first of all say that I'm not a partisan person, so I see the province as being the province, whatever the government happens to be in power at the time. And I think there's probably a bit of a fear in provincial politics for getting too close to this because of the amount of the public perception and anger and response towards any kind of new tax. I mean, you know, there's certain media in town that attack the discussion before it even takes place, and of course it sends politicians running for the weeds, especially if you're within a year and a half of an election. And I think that what has to happen is, whether it's the Liberals or the NDP who are forming the next government, it's very important that groups like Hub, UDI, BC Truckers Association, the chambers of all the chambers of commerce, is engaged directly with the provincial government and say, look, we're part of this discussion from an economic point of view, from a healthy community's point of view, from advocating alternative source of transportation. We want to be part of that discussion, and we want you at the table as well. What are you afraid of? This is an opportunity for provincial government to show some incredible leadership. I can tell, I was in Ontario back in November and chatting with the folks who are involved in transit within Southern Ontario, and I can tell you, I mean, we've got far fewer challenges and problems here from a governance perspective, despite everything we've been talking about here, than they do in Ontario. Nancy, you were there at that conference with me. It is a mess. Politically, oh my goodness, even within Toronto City Council, it's just you're just all over the map. They have major, major issues to do with the regional government within Southern Ontario to deal with before they even get at transit. We don't. We know for the most part here, I tell you, Metro Vancouver functions very well. It's a very civil organization with a high level of functionality, despite what the province may think. And the TransLink board and the previous TransLink board also did as well. So a lot of these are myths. You know, where we clash occasionally, and I think you know, that those of you who know your local history, where the clashes came was when it was a question of federal and provincial money coming down into the transit system, and the federal and provincial government wanting either perhaps jobs for Eastern Canadian companies, for large companies to be involved in contracts, and wanting particular routes for political reasons because of provincial and federal commitments. I can tell you, when the Evergreen Line got approved a year and a half ago, it was very clear if we started negotiating at all the technology or the route, the money was off the table. It was like, here's your $400 million from the province, from the feds, here's $400 million from the province, and that's where it goes, and you've got X number of months in order to, Jeff, correct me if I'm wrong, you're part of those discussions, and that's the way it's got to be. So, there was no discussion among us as to whether the Northeast was still the best place or if things had changed. It was simple. $800 million would have walked off the table out of the region, and probably $400 million to Ontario or Quebec if we hadn't moved ahead with that. So that's the kind of challenge we have in trying to get our heads together constructively right now. We're not all working on the same page at different levels of government. Sorry, that's very candid for those of you who are listening, but that's the truth. Okay.
So I have one question from Twitter. Somebody's asking, why is property tax maxed out? As you say, cities such as Portland have higher rates.
Well, I think what you found is when the property tax was introduced, and this I looked to the resident historians here. Again, I have to look to our journalists, to Price and Megs here, to recite the history. But I know when property tax first came on as a source, it was George Peel, I believe, was the one who was going around to make sure it never went up, was never going to go above 7% or 12%. And I think it's sitting now at, what was the number I said, 23. It's at 23% right now, and the province is still, quite frankly, is sitting back and saying, you know, that there is a source, it's property tax. The province, I think, feels very clearly, I can't speak for the NDP, but it's certainly, I think, from the Liberals' perspective, that there's still tax room left for property tax. But I can tell you, municipal governments get 8% of the tax revenue generated in Canada. 8% flows through the municipal levels. Look at everything we provide for 8%. You know, it's a huge amount, and there's an awful lot of families. We talk about the affordability for families that the premier's talking about. Well, I can tell you that rent tenancy costs, those all flow through to whether you're renting or paying property taxes through your rent. It all, you know, nobody gets an exemption from that. So I don't think property tax can go any higher at this point. Also, it's the only source of revenue that most of us have. 55% of our revenue in North End District comes from property tax. The other 45% comes from fees. And believe me, our community is just railing against fees. Fees for water, fees for engineering designs, fees for approvals, fees for even parking meters. I tell you, my political death in my community would be if I introduced even one parking meter, I'd probably be history, you know, a footnote in history. So people push back on fees. Am I right, Anne? Thank you. Yeah. Anyway, so property tax is from a political point of view, and from a functional point of view, for a lot of people, you know, who are paying already 40, 50, 60% of their family income to try and live in their house, it's just not affordable. Jeff?
But Richard, didn't the direct answer, I thought, was that the legislation linked property tax and fares. So from a provincial standpoint, they wanted to be sure that the mayors did take some heat and did raise some revenue, and that the fares did as well, and that was there was an equal sharing, supposedly equitable sharing across the driver community. So they were working together, and then the legislative caucus put on, and we're at that cap. Okay. So okay. It's a political level. It could be higher, but people would have to make their own political
decisions. Okay, thanks, Jeff, for clarifying that. I didn't know that. Okay.
Hi, I'm over here.
There you go. Okay.
My name is Jacob Fox. I'm a master's student here at SFU in the Energy and Materials Research Group. My question is about, I was hoping you could clarify the carbon tax lever. How would you propose changing the current carbon tax? Would you want to raise it or not have it be revenue neutral?
Sure. Well, I can give my response, and I'm going to go to Megs and Price again because they've probably written about it and probably have a broader policy understanding than I do. But I think the carbon tax, there's no future for it beyond, I think, the next couple of months, i.e., whether it's going to be continued or discontinued, or whether it's going to be increased for the benefit of public transportation or whatever, that really is depends upon which particular party's elected and what policy they have. I don't think the Liberals have committed themselves at this point to any additional carbon tax, but it's been from the very beginning by legislation revenue neutral, which means that it comes in taken in the left pocket from carbon tax, goes out the right pocket in tax reductions and remittances to low-income people, et cetera. So in the brief conversations I had with Adrian Dix, my understanding is that the NDP is looking at carbon taxes likely being if there's any future revenue for TransLink, carbon tax is the most likely. Now, I don't know if you can... Is that correct? Okay, I'm not misrepresenting anything. And I don't think the Liberals have made a commitment at this point. I think they likely will develop that policy after the election. So it's a good question to ask both political parties. But the broader question is, how are you going to, you know, how are you going to fund? The question we're certainly asking and putting pressure on both parties is, how are you going to fund public transportation within the region? We haven't, at this point, I don't see both parties desperate to get out there and commit because... As the CBC asked me this morning, but that'll mean new taxes. That'll mean people have to pay. Well, of course. I mean, 40% is paid from the fare box. The other 60 cents that every time you get on a bus or SkyTrain, 60 cents has to come from somewhere. And if you expand the system, you've even got a greater subsidy because you got a larger system that needs to be subsidized. So, yes, obviously, it has to come from somewhere, and it's going to come out of your pocket and my pocket. The question is, what behavior are you going to try and work with in order to fairly, you know, take those additional funds and try and provide the benefits.
John Kelmente with the Sustainable Transportation Coalition. Going back to this idea of sales tax, I think one of the main issues for people with any new tax is that they feel it's going to go into a big pot of money that's they could be putting buses on the road that they're not going to be using, for example. And I wonder if any additional sales tax, if it's proposed, could go to a specific suite of improvements, either capital or operating, in each district, each area, so people would know exactly what that fund, all those funds are going to. I don't know if this proposal was for an increased tax or for part of an existing tax, but that, I think, is one of the main issues. People feel it's not going to something that I can see, that I see the improvements in my area.
Mm-hmm. You see, I think there's a typical example of a comment that needs to be heard. You've taken us wanting to get it out in public conversation, you've taken it further. And that's part of the public conversation dialogue we need to have. Very interesting idea. And I think that certainly people, my experience with people, is they don't mind paying for something if they see a direct, as you said, a direct connection for what they're paying and what value they're getting back. And I know the mayor who's most actively talking in those terms is Mayor Jackson from Delta, who's providing statistics saying that she thinks that they're getting less value for what their citizens put in Delta than in almost anywhere else in Metro Vancouver. And it could well be some truth from that. I would have to guess that the communities that are most spread out, and I mean, Delta is a unique community with Ladner, Tawasin, and North Delta separated by, 10, 15, 20 kilometers. People in Delta travel more in their cars per capita than anyone else in Metro Vancouver. I know that for a fact. And therefore are likely paying more through gas tax and everything else towards TransLink. So, but in order to have that discussion and mind that observation you make, the discussion needs to take place. And I guess that's where we're stuck at. So,
okay. If we have a question.
Yep.
Thanks, Elodie. Mayor Walton, when you're looking at what's stuck, how do you unstick it? Is the issue funding? Is it land use? And how do we get at that? And what needs to happen at a broader level to get us beyond where we are right now?
Oh, I think it's just trust. I think it's just simple trust. And I think in politics, relationships are everything. In business, relationships are everything. In our lives, relationships are everything. And I came onto this train fairly late. I think many of us who are here on the board right now, the members of the TransLink board who are here, many of us who are in elected public office, we've come in onto a moving train. And sometimes there's perceptions and policy that goes back long before I'm around. That's why I'm turning to several of our resident journalists and academics, whatever, who are here, who have an understanding of that longer path. I don't quite understand. I'm not particularly connected to Victoria. In any way. I'm not. I know our local MLAs reasonably well, and that's about it. So I don't understand sometimes where these perceptions come from. But I know that there was probably some pretty cantankerous stuff that went on between local governments and probably the province, probably back, 5, 10, 15 years ago. And I think the residual for some of that is still there. I think there's a lot of political fear that I think if Victoria comes too far in terms of sitting at the table. Let me give you an example. It's the former TransLink board that I was on, okay, had, again, correct me if I'm wrong, I think there were 15 seats and 3 were reserved for the province. Is that correct, Jeff? And I think that was set up in the late 90s. The province, I think, never filled those board seats. Because I think what happened, the legislation was set up, and then they thought, gosh, we have 3 provincial MLAs or representatives sitting with 12 mayors and councillors. We're a minority. Nothing good can come from that. So those board seats went unfilled for like 7, 8 years. They filled them, but they never showed up. In fact, the same thing. So there was a hesitancy to come to the table. I think recently we point out the fact that the current appointed board, okay, was our view. I think most of the people in Mayor's Council is that it needs to be at least some appointed mayors and councillors as part of the TransLink board, because the public sort of, I think, expects that. It's one of the issue of transparency, et cetera. And the legislation was changed last May. To have myself and Wainwright, I have a seat on the board, and Mayor's Council has indicated that they don't think the chair and vice chair should sit because then we'd be a minority of two, with fearful Nancy Oleweiler up there, scary Nancy, and the rest of the board, and I'm of mixed views on it, but I'm representing the views of the whole. And I think that we need to have a board that my personal view, and this has not been discussed. We're waiting for the governance comments to come back. But I think the board should be a hybrid board. I think you have to have people from the province and from local government and academics and experts. Some of you who are in this room should be on the board as well, so we have a good balanced conversation. And I think until that happens, we're going to be continuing to have these struggles. So
to be clear, you fix the governance, you get the money. The money will flow. We'll be okay.
I think you fix the governance, it will be a much easier conversation to have because the trust issues will be dealt with. Yep.
Okay, so one more question from Twitter. Yep. Aside from social benefits, has TransLink calculated the wider return on investment for taxpayer contributions to transit mega projects?
Well, you look at Jeff right in the eye because that would probably end up on his desk if I guess.
Not directly.
No. Okay, I know Nancy, did you want to comment on that at all from board perspective? Or?
I'm sorry, the question was, does transportation help improve the economy? Emphatically, yes. How can you imagine a vibrant economic unit without a fully functioning transportation network? But maybe that wasn't the question. Jordan will interpret the question.
Dr. Price.
You're changing my reputation. I think the frame is completely different. And the best illustration I can give is how we evaluated the cost of people's time. With the Portman Bridge, congestion was valued. The number of people caught in delay, the time they were delayed, and the value of their time, and that number justified the widest bridge in the world. When the premier did not want to make a decision, she said, TransLink needs to be audited. And what did the audit recommend? That we increase the time between SkyTrain cars, that we take out low-performing routes, that we induce delay. And we accepted that. TransLink was considered to be a social service, and that by increasing people's time, we increased efficiency. With roads, that same kind of delay was considered a cost, and it had to be reduced at billions. The TransLink board said the same message. We will accept the constraints we're in, and we will basically manage decline, except for the Patullo Bridge. That we will give the go-ahead on. We've done the same with the Massey Tunnel. Delay there justifies us moving forward without conversation. It's just assumed that that's going to go ahead. And you, meanwhile, you've already articulated so well, are struggling to figure out how you do the conversation. You say that goods movement shouldn't have to fight for passenger dollars. There's no fight for goods movement. They get what they want. They have their alliance. They set their priorities. They go to the highest levels. The announcements are made. $25 billion is going to be spent, according to the Minister of Transportation, $25 billion to 2020 on transportation infrastructure in this province. If we took 10 or 15% of that, you get everything you need in the way of transit. But that discussion's not going to happen.
I think discussion's going to happen right now because Dr. Oldwater's got her hand up there. So, okay. I can't call you Dr. Oldwater because you are a doctor. Yeah.
I completely agree with his esteemed, whatever we want to call him, Dr. Mr. Price on the congestion costs as well, and that goes into the economic vibrancy of a city. I just want to clarify a couple of things that Gord said. Number one, the Patullo Bridge is not a done deal. All we are doing on the Patullo Bridge is ensuring the damn thing, it's being taped, that it does not fall down. It's a public health and safety issue right now. There is no decision made on the Patullo Bridge. We have no way to fund it because we have no authority to fund it, nor should we fund anything until the integrated transportation flows along that region are satisfied. On the audits, I presume you're talking about the recent two or three of them that we've had over the last 6 months or so. So, you know, inefficiency is always an easy argument to make. You're inefficient, therefore you have no social license with which to go to the public to ask for money. And it keeps getting thrown in our face. Every audit says, yes, there's room for improvement. But every audit also says, yes, you guys are operating really efficiently. And so what are we doing about it? We are operating within our means right now. We are not cutting service. What we cannot do is grow. And this is the issue that Richard's addressing that we're all trying to address and saying, come on, folks, what kind of community do you want to live in? Do you want to live in a community where we have to have a debate every time? You know, let's talk about the airport. How do they fund their investment? Do they go to the public? Well, they do, but it's because it's already a hidden tax. We need something equivalent to the airport improvement fee, which says that every time you get on a plane, you're paying it. You don't even know you pay it. I've always argued we should have secret taxes that nobody sees because then they wouldn't know what they're paying for. You know, when you get on a flight at YVR, do you say, oh my gosh, I'm paying that darn tax again. Why did I do this? But we don't get that kind of discussion. I agree with Gord. Why can't we have the same kind of discussion?
Because airports are not seen by decision makers as a social service.
Right. So I agree with that. I just wanted to clarify we're not caving in.
But your leadership is required to change that frame.
We are not caving in.
No pasarán.
Neither is Richard.
Where is the board leading that? You're expecting the mayor's council to do that.
No, we're not. No, their mayor's...
Richard, we got to talk outside the room. No, I mean, the issue right now, as Richard has very clearly articulated, is you've got to get what is the answer to Shauna. Everybody's got to be at the table and sit down and have an adult conversation.
This is getting very heated.
There's a gentleman at the back, too, with his hand up.
I don't know
how long you've got.
We have at least four more questions, and we're running out of time, so...
You can conclude formally. I'm not running away if people want to ask questions. I mean, I'm here till 4, apparently, so there.
Well, I know Mayor Walton has to get to a meeting with our director in a few minutes, so I'm going to have to cut it short. But I wanted to tell you, we are hosting another dialogue with, hopefully, candidates for the next provincial election in April. And it will be about public transit, so please come.
April 18th.
April 18th, here at SFU. And hopefully we will have all candidates present and you'll be able to ask more questions and keep the debate going.
Could I just ask a question? If I could, okay. And I think I know the answer. Is anyone here from the province? This is a constant. All the stakeholder groups are in the room and the province isn't. And this is in almost wherever it takes place. And you can see there's not much disagreement in this room, even with the dueling doctors. I mean, it's about policy. I don't know where the argument is. It's about getting together and figuring it out, to me. It's a simple world, I think. So,
So I want to thank you all for coming and making time for Mayor Walton today. Thank you, Mayor Walton, for
this. You're more than welcome.
Great
thank
conference.
You. I learned a lot, too, so thanks so much.